couldn't start the sermon. I apologize for that. But we are going to be doing a sermon series talking about leadership within the church, and especially talking about leadership in times of transition, talking about people and the biblical stories and the biblical text who basically went from one leader to another. And we're learning some leadership principles on that as well. So if you have your Bible, get it open to Deuteronomy chapter 31. We'll be there in just a moment. But the bottom line up front is this, that those who lead must intentionally pour into another person in order to be a successful leader and create a lasting legacy. Those who lead must be successfully pouring into another person or multiple people in order to create a lasting legacy. So my family and I, we are people who like to work out. I know it sounds weird, you know, but that's one of the things that we love to do. So we work out as a family about 5 times a week. We do lifting and cardio, switching between cycling and running. I hate running. It's the worst thing on planet Earth, but we do it. Mostly because the Air Force requires me to run, and so I have to. But anyway, what's happened over the last few years is that our children are actually starting to take part in that as well. And so our son, he started this out, and he started out, you know, lifting with us, and then our daughter started this out as well, and even little Beckett, he's going down, and we force him to go on the treadmill. We don't have him do weights yet, but he does the treadmill and stuff like that, and so it's just part of our natural life. And you know what's funny is I sometimes catch our kids kind of looking at themselves in the mirror, kind of checking out their muscle. And like I'm not going to name names, but there's one in particular who's a little bit older. It's like, look at this dad. You know, and it's kind of cool, you know. And they're, my oldest, he is going to be bigger than me, which is sad. But I can still take him, at least for another year or two. But it's kind of neat when you develop that legacy and when you see that your kids love something and that they're probably going to keep doing that as they grow up because it's just part of who they are now. And so that's one of the ways that we lead in our family, because for us, health and wellness is biblical. You know, our body is a temple and we want to take care of that because it's the only body we have. And so we are stewards of God's resources there. Now, we all have times in our life in which we lead. Think about a mother duck and all their ducklings, you know, following along. We wouldn't say that's a leader, you know, but it is, because she is telling the ducks where to go simply by walking ahead. And oftentimes, that's all we need to do. So as parents and grandparents, we walk ahead for our kids. We lead in many different ways. Some of us, when we're in school, or some of us who have kids in school, there's sometimes tasks and projects, and you know what? Sometimes you have to step up and lead that project. That's some of the earliest leadership that we have. How about finding a problem at work? And oftentimes, if you find the problem, they'll be like, okay, offer a solution. And so even if you don't see yourself as a leader, you still have to find the solution to fix the problem. How about bringing in snacks for the fellowship time or starting coffee? What you're doing there is you're leading the church in that activity. So we all lead in some way, shape, or form. So my question is what does godly leadership look like? You know, the Bible actually talks quite a bit about what leadership in the biblical setting looks like. And today in chapter 31 of Deuteronomy, we're going to look at Moses and his leadership transition from Moses to Joshua. And so it starts off in Deuteronomy 31, verse 1. And it says, then Moses went out and spoke these words to all Israel. I am now 120 years old, and I am no longer able to lead you. The Lord has said, you shall not cross the Jordan. The Lord your God himself will cross over ahead of you. He will destroy these nations before you, and you will take possession of their land. Joshua will also cross over ahead of you, as the Lord has said. Now, skip down to verse 7, and it says, then Moses summoned Joshua and said to him in the presence of all Israel, be strong and courageous, for you must go with this people into the land that the Lord has sworn to your ancestors to give them, and you must divide it among them as their inheritance. The Lord himself will go before you and will be with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. So, right off the bat, we have this simple principle in which we learn that leadership is always temporary. leadership is always temporary. Even Moses, who is 120 years old at this time, which is pretty old, he's only a temporary leader. And one of the main things that we've learned in the Bible is that we are only stewards of the resources that God gives us. And one of the resources that God gives us is leading other people. We're only entrusted as leaders for a specific time period. Now, for those of us who have raised up kids, we understand this pretty well. All right, so when our kids are younger, we raise them up and we teach them and we can instruct them pretty well. And then when they become teenagers, we still continue to teach and instruct them, but we have to do it in a little bit different way so that they don't despise us, right? And then when they become adults, we shift over into that mentor and coaching kind of phase of life, because they're still going to come to us with their problems and with their issues, but maybe not quite as frequently. You know, maybe sometimes they do all the time, but we are changing in our roles, but we're still leading all the way through, but we don't have as much leadership over them as we once did. See, we're only a leader for a period of time, and then they grow into successful, healthy adults, we hope, right? Likewise, a coach, they're only a temporary leader of the teams that they coach. Pastors, we're not here forever. We're only the temporary leaders for the churches that we pastor. CEOs may own the business, or they may not, but they're only the boss for a period of time. Now, a wise leader knows that leadership is only temporary, and this is what Moses knows as well. And a wise leader will also prepare the leaders for the future. Moses, he wasn't always like this, but he taught up leaders. But there's a moment in his life that changed everything. After the Exodus, Moses was leading millions of people, millions of Israelites by himself. And he would spend basically from morning until night sitting on the judgment throne, basically helping them kind of figure out, okay, who's right, who's wrong, sort of like a judge over all Israel. And his father-in-law came to visit him one day. His father-in-law's name was Jethro, perhaps the coolest name in the entire Bible. And he says, "What is this thing that you're doing with all the people? Why are you alone sitting as judge while all the people stand around you from morning until night?" And then Jethro goes on to give a method for how you lead. And he says this: select honorable, wise, and godly men. Teach them the basic interpretation of God's laws and instructions. Now develop a pattern of taking the power that you have and giving it to other people, divesting. All right, and then replicate that leadership throughout the Israelites. And the result was this: Moses continued to lead, which meant that there was less stress in his life. He was sustained for the long haul, and he had more hands to carry the burden. Now, think of this image when you're carrying a coffin, if you're at a graveside, and there's six people who are carrying the coffin, right? Now, if you had two people trying to carry that coffin, there's no way you could do it. Those things are heavy. Coffins are very difficult to carry. But when you have six people, it becomes very manageable. It's still difficult, but it's manageable. This is what Moses had. The burden of leadership was heavy, but it became manageable as he started to give power to other people, and they started to carry the burden along with him. Moses also had more time in his life. He had more people who were leading, and then by result of that, more people were being served. So all around, it was a really good thing that Jethro stepped into his life and said, "Hey, you can't do this alone. You need to raise up other people." And so Moses intentionally developed Joshua, and Joshua came alongside him. Joshua was there when Moses went up and got the Ten Commandments. Joshua was also there when Moses got angry because they made the golden calf. He threw them down to the ground. He was a witness of God's presence when God's presence filled the tabernacle. Moses was with Joshua nearly all the time that Joshua was there. And here's what Moses did. His legacy is this. Number one, he ensured that the people loved and feared the Lord. Number two, he poured his life into other people as he led. And number three, he had a leader ready to go on day one. Those are all pretty important things. But I want to give you three lessons that we learn from Moses' leadership within the Word. Number one is this: the success of a leader is not measured by their accomplishments. All right. Sometimes we look at people who are doing great things and we say, "Wow, what a great leader." They are. But the true test is when they lead. All right. So the success of a leader is not measured by their accomplishments, it's measured by the success of their successor. So the person who follows them, if they are successful, that meant that they led well. So Moses' leadership works today. What we see with Moses is he's thinking about the future. He's investing and he's empowering young people to do what he was doing. He felt responsible not only for himself and his people that were his age, but also the younger people who were coming up as well. A leader who is not developing future leaders is either, one, too busy to think about it, thinking about only the here and now, or they're being selfish and kind of hoarding what they have, their resources. I want to give you an example of this. So over at the Bloomfield Church, Christopher and Megan, they just had their baby Cameron. And the week after Cameron was born, they brought Cameron to the church. And he's a beautiful little baby, dark, dark hair. No, I'm just joking, totally blonde because they're both really blonde. And Cameron, like, this is all Cameron's ever gonna know, because every single week they bring him to church and he sits in there for an hour with everybody else. Now, I said that this at the first service, and I've told Christopher and Megan this, but it's like, that's what we did with our kids too. And our kids sit through the whole church service and they're fine with it. They enjoy it. It's part of their day-to-day life, and they appreciate the fellowship and the community because that's what they know. You know, they were raised by the church, and you all became their family, and they love being here. It's not, it doesn't feel like an obligation. It's just who they are, what they do. See, kind of like the mother duck with the ducklings following behind, the mother duck is out in the front saying, this is what we do. You know, this is where we go. This is how we live our lives. And we as leaders, especially as parents, we can bring our children up in the same way and say, okay, this is what we do. This is what we eat at the table. We go to church. We talk about things in our life. See, like Moses, we raise up our successors by basically having them come along with us. That's what Moses did with Joshua. Everywhere that Moses was, Joshua was there as well. Simply put, leaders, we must be raising up the next generation. And the simplest, easiest way to do this is to simply have them come with us. So the success of a leader is not measured by their accomplishments. It's measured by the success of their successor. And that's what we see. Joshua is very successful in his leadership. All right. We'll talk about Joshua and his successors in just a little bit. But that's one metric that we can say this is a successful leader. And we only know that once they're gone. Second thing that we learn from Moses is that a leader steers legacy. So some of you have heard of a little company called GE, right? General Electric. And GE has been around for the last 100 years or so. During the 80s, there was a guy named Jack Welch who took over this as the CEO of GE. Jack Welch basically developed this leadership style within the corporation in which the lowest performers were always cut. So if you were a low performer in the top 10% or the lowest 10%, you were, in a sense, fired. Now, what do you think this did to the culture? Basically, it was a culture in which I'm going to backstab you. I'm going to do whatever I can to be over and above you because I don't want to be cut. I don't want my job to go away. So it was all about the short-term gain. It was all about next quarter or the end of the year, end of the fiscal year. Who can be in the top group, right? And it created this dog-eat-dog culture, and it was truly unsustainable. Now, what happened over the time was that company, it did grow, and it did see some moderate gains, but at the same time, once he left, and once a few years passed by, that culture basically made the whole company crumble, and now GE is just kind of like a shell of what they used to be. Now, at the same time that GE was really rising up in that late 80s and mid 80s and early 90s and so on, there's another company led by another CEO, and this company was called Costco. And they said, you know what, at Costco, what we're going to do is we're going to create a culture which we want people to feel like their family. We want to embody trust. We want to pay people a livable salary and provide benefits. We want people to feel like this is a place that they love. Now, Costco had a very low turnover rate, and over time, they actually outperform GE in their stocks. So from 86 until the time that it was the height of GE's stock, GE grew by 600%. In that same period of time, cost growth grew by 1,200%. And it's all because of the leadership, and basically the leader was steering the legacy of the corporation. Now, when we look at these companies today, GE is just a shell of what they used to be. What happened with Costco? Costco is one of the greatest companies around, and it's still thriving, still going very well. It just shows you that a good leader will still steer the legacy. They will tell you, okay, this is what we're about. We're gonna create healthy environments. We want us to survive and thrive. We want people to feel like they're part of a family. See, Moses, he is described in Numbers as one of the most humble men that has ever lived. He is about building up other people. He is about team building. And he steered the legacy. He created a culture in which the legacy was this, that we are people who build up and train up the next generation. And so what I want you to know is this, that the leader will steer the legacy of the church, of the family, of the workplace, and so on. And I'm sure you've seen this as well. The last thing that we learn from Moses is this, that a successful leader always has a wingman or a co-pilot or a deputy, somebody else who's leading along with them. All right, Moses, he poured into Joshua. He took him everywhere he went, right? And for 80 years, Moses led the Israelites. Leaders are always temporary. And Joshua was a proven leader. By the time that Joshua took over, he already was a leader within the Israelites. But when you look at his time in office, time as a leader, you look at his resume, it's pretty impressive. To this day, scholars say that Joshua was one of the best military leaders of all time. And he was, really. When you think about the people that he went up against, the Canaanites, they had been there in those fortified cities for thousands of years. No one was able to dislodge them until Joshua came, and he had this ragtag group of people, and he took over. He's a great military leader. He also had a rock-solid faith. He had a zeal for the Lord. Yet the true measure of leadership is what? Their accomplishments? No, it's their successor. Now, we have no record of Joshua leading somebody else to take over. We have no record of Joshua pouring into another person. And here's what happens a generation after Joshua is done leading, generation after he dies, the people did not know the Lord. They drifted from the Lord. They went into a period of chaos. This is the book of Judges. All right, and at the end of the book of Judges, it says this, at this time, there was no king of Israel, and everyone did what is right in their own eyes. So basically, we went from Moses, and just a generation or two later, people didn't even know the Lord anymore. So why was there this stark contrast? Well, because Joshua was a military leader. He was a person who was basically doing this great campaign. He was putting all of his focus on destroying the enemy, and he did a really, really good job with that. But he never did train up somebody else. Here's the thing. He was a busy guy. He has a lot of excuses of why he could not train up another person. But here's the thing. We need to be training up other people. How many of us have ever said, you know, it's easier for me just to do it by myself? You don't have to raise your hand, but we've all said that, right? Or when your kids wanted to help you out with something, you're like, no, I've got this. I'll do it. You know? I've known myself to say this numerous times. You know, if I want it done right, I'm just going to do it myself. Here's the thing. We are too busy not to raise up leaders. We are too busy not to raise up leaders. Because we are only temporary. We need to invest the extra time in training. We need to have people come alongside of us. You know, so if your kids want to help you out with something, say, okay, yes, it's going to take a little bit more time and things are going to get messier. But you know what? Once we do this together, they're going to know how to do it. And then they can do it the next time. You know, for instance, Beckett, for some reason, he loves hot dogs. All right. And so he'd always be like, hey, Dad, can you put some hot dogs in the oven for me? Or the air fryer, that's what we usually use. And so I'm like, okay, one day I'm like, okay, I'm tired of doing this. Beckett, get the hot dogs out, put them in the air fryer yourself. And he's like, okay. And so he put them in there, and he's like, how do I start it? I'm like, you push that button. He's like, okay. And then, this is the part that I didn't tell Meredith about until later. I was like, see that little glove over there? Okay, make sure you put the glove on, and then take the hot dogs out, and then put them on the counter. And he's like, okay. And then after that, I mean, he's never asked me to make hot dogs ever again. Because here's this kid who's, you know, he's 9 years old. He's old enough to do this kind of stuff. So when he wants food, he goes to the freezer, gets the hot dogs out. He puts them in the rack, turns it all on himself. He waits 10 minutes, and takes the glove, puts them out, takes the bread. And if he needs to thaw it out in the microwave, he puts it in the microwave, gets the plate out. And, you know, he does all this stuff by himself. Now, I could still be doing all of it for him, but he knows how to do it. So we need to invest the extra time in training. And yeah, it takes a little bit of time up front, but the end result is that people know how to do it. And in a few weeks, I'm going to talk a little bit more about Jesus, but Jesus really provides us with the ultimate leadership model. His model is this. He picked 12 disciples, and of those 12 disciples, he chose three who were going to be like the top disciples. And he was with those 12 disciples every single day, teaching them, training them, walking alongside of them. And then even then, he sent them out two by two. And those two disciples actually recruited 10 more disciples, 10 more followers. And they went out and they did the ministry that Jesus was doing. So you went from 13 people, Jesus plus the 12, and they were doing all this ministry. And now you multiply that because now we have 72 people going out and doing the exact same ministry. Now, here's the thing. Jesus saved the world from sin, and he also took time to raise up the next generation of leaders. I think we have time to do that as well. So what would it look like for us to do this? See, we each have opportunities in our life to lead other people. It could be our grandkids. It could be a task at school or at work. It could be even bringing in things for the fellowship hour. Do you lead like Moses, where you bring other people along with you? Or do you lead like Joshua, where you say, I'm just going to focus on getting it done. I don't have time for this. I don't have time to train anyone else. Are you too busy to train others? Or are you intentionally finding other people to train? What would it look like if we began to apply these biblical leadership lessons into our life, into our work, into our family, into our church? You know, I said this at the first service, and I said to the Bloomfield Church, over the last few years, I've been pulling back. I've been basically pulling back from the church because we have all the leaders here already. We have people who are leading small groups. We have people leading the blessing box and things like that. And my job as a pastor is to get those things started, to help people get the resources they need. But then my job is to pull back and say, okay, you are empowered. Go. Train up more leaders so that it continues on, but go and do this. And my job as a pastor has gone from very tactical, like hands in the dirt, you know, all the stuff, getting all the stuff the ministry is going, to a person who's kind of, I'm here to support the people who are leading the church. And so what I want to leave you with is this. Our parish will have a new church pastor. His name is Tom. But the leadership is already here. So even though we have a new pastor, the leadership is already here. Because you are all the leaders already. So my question is, how will you continue to shape and lead this church and continue to shape and lead your life, your family, your work, even in your retirement? There are places for you to lead. Will you train up the next people to go forward and be your successor? Let's take a moment and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word is practical and it teaches us how we live in our lives. Lord, help us to be like Moses. Help us to intentionally find people to pour into so that they can lead in their life as well. Lord, help us to be people of your word, people of the resurrection who place our hope in you, in your son, Jesus Christ. Help us to go forward in that powerful name, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, I invite you to stand.